Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Holes in the Sky by Mark Reps, narrated by Malcolm Hillgartner. Chapter 1. Under the dimly lit sky, an effeminate hand gripped the shoulder of a nearly flaccid body and shook with unseeming strength. The clearing of a throat echoed in the otherwise silent night.
"You're still with me, aren't you, Padre? Padre?"
The man dressed in the collar of a Catholic priest remained slumped over in the front seat of his station wagon, his nearly lifeless, drooling lips pressed against the passenger window. His eyes stared mindlessly into a rapidly approaching oblivion. Any semblance of voluntary control was rapidly ebbing into an unholy blackness from which death could be his only escape.
"Last rites, Padre. Extreme unction. How does the sound of that ring in your ears?"
The religious man dug deeply into the last vestiges of his manhood. A vain attempt to curse his captor barely exuded from his dying lips. With a stronger, more confident air, the captor spoke again.
"Say that again, would you, Padre? I couldn't quite make it out."
A wheezing grunt oozed through his lips.
"Jesus sheds not a tear for a dying fool headed for hell."
The dying priest's stomach spasmed. A curdled glob of black and green fluid escaped unceremoniously through his flared nostrils. The driver shook his head in revulsion.
"Keep it together, Father. You're beginning to disgust me."
The watering eyes of the man in the collar disappeared somewhere deep into the back of his skull.
"What time frame does canon law prescribe as proper for the final sacrament?"
The sorrowful echo of the priest's unintelligible dying voice volleyed around the inside of the car. The driver, stirred by its eeriness, grabbed the holy man by the collar and jerked him upright.
"Now listen up, Padre. About my religious legal inquiry? Must last rites be administered within an hour of death? Or must the sacrament be administered prior to passing? If memory serves me correctly, I believe tradition demands the anointment of the dying must be administered before the soul departs the body. One of the great philosophical questions of all time, eh, Padre? Padre?"
The priest, held upright by a seatbelt, slumped limply forward in his seat. The man behind the wheel reached over, snatched him roughly by the hair, and growled his question sternly.
"When precisely does the soul exit the body? Can you feel it leaving your body? More importantly, can you sense the direction it's heading? Tell me, Padre, is your soul going to heaven, or is it going to meet its doom in oblivion? If I were a gambler, I would put my money on hell."
The priest's strength had vanished. He could not even stir.
"Certainly the wise men in Rome who govern the church have issued an edict or two on the subject."
The priest's corporal body collapsed into its final survival mode. He now breathed only the rasp of death.
"What? Speak up. You haven't answered my question. Maybe you don't have the answer? Don't worry. You will soon enough."
The driver pulled the car off the smooth pavement into a low wash. He parked behind a thicket of scraggly scrub brush and switched off the engine. Reaching over, he grabbed the priest's shoulder and shook him violently. When the holy man failed to respond, the driver reached into the glove compartment. He removed a small vial. It was labeled Holy Water, St. Barnabas Church. The driver took a swallow, tipped his head back, and gargled before spitting the liquid onto the face of the dying man. The barely conscious priest managed a small gurgle through purplish-blue foam-covered lips.
"Stay with me now, palsy-wowsy. The best, as they say, is yet to come. Where is your God now, Padre? Hiding in the bushes? Waiting to save you? Why don't you have a little look around? Maybe you can find him for me."
The driver grabbed the priest and twisted his neck, giving him a complete scan of the surrounding area.
"Nope, I don't think so. Your savior has left you on your own. God Almighty has abandoned you in your time of need. Irony, fate, your call, Padre.
The driver released the priest's neck from his grip. From behind the seat, he extracted a pair of neatly folded surgical gloves and a miner's hat. He methodically checked the brightness of the hat's lamp before forcing it tightly on his head. Finger by finger, he tightened the gloves snugly around his smooth, uncalloused hands.
Now don't go away, Padre. I'll be right back, I promise.
The man hopped out of the priest's station wagon. He lowered the back gate and grabbed the legs of a rocking chair. He grunted as he tugged hard on the wooden legs of the chair. The chair smacked clumsily onto the ground. The man's eyes and ears suddenly tuned into the surrounding night. Assured no one was approaching, he flicked on the helmet's light. He grabbed the rocker and fought clumsily through the underbrush. When he reached a previously chosen spot in the ditch, he relieved himself of the burden. He took a moment to catch his breath as he squinted long and hard down the vanishing roadway. Confident he was alone, he ambled back to the car. He shouldered his prey, using the adrenaline surge that comes with the power of death over life.
I hope you're easier to wrangle than that goddamn rocker of yours.
The dying priest's stench-filled breath echoed shallowly in his captor's ear.
What's that?
Asked the man.
You're slurring your speech. Speak clearly if you expect to be spoken to.
Suddenly a rustling froze him like stone. It was only a night animal scurrying through the underbrush. A chuckle pursed his lips.
The dark of night, Padre, is the time the devil collects his due. I don't need to tell you that. That's common knowledge to a man of the cloth, is it not?
Carefully he laid the nearly dead weight on the lip of the highway. He took extra caution to make certain the priest's head didn't smash against the pavement.
Lucky you, Padre. The pavement is still warm. Let us call it my way of giving comfort to the dying. No one wants to die alone in a cold, hard bed.
The man retightened his gloves and glanced up beyond the nearby peak of Mount Graham. The night sky was pregnant with a bounty of stars.
It just doesn't get any more beautiful than this, he sighed. Life is beautiful. And death. Talk to me, Father. Is the Grim Reaper casting his shadow over you yet?
Stepping down into the ditch, he grabbed the rocking chair and dragged it into the westbound lane. He triangulated with his hands to make certain the rocker was in the dead center of the lane.
Fill in the blank for me, Padre. Death is... Come on now. Death is... You know the answer. Death is... Perfection, he sneered. And he is your next visitor.
Reaching under the unconscious priest's arms, he hoisted him into the chair. As the man stood back to survey his handiwork, he realized something was missing.
Ah, yes. How silly of me.
His heart pitter-pattered with glee as he sprinted back through the underbrush to the station wagon. He reached under the seat.
There you are, you little devil.
Dashing back through the arroyo, he emerged precisely where he had left his conquest.
Here you go, Padre. You might want this where you're going.
He slipped the priest's personal Bible into his bluish fingers.
I understand St. Peter is partial to those who cough up an entrance fee.
The rites of extreme unction were administered ritualistically. When the sacrament was fully dispensed, he kissed the priest on the forehead. With a smile, the blesser tipped the priest's head toward the heavens and hoarsely bellowed one final benediction.
God, I know you're out there. I know you can hear me. Get ready. I am returning another sacrificial lamb to heaven's flock.
Having spoken his mind, the man trotted a half mile down the road where he had hidden his vehicle behind an abandoned gas station. Chapter 2. It's 2:45. There's no one in the place except you and me. The sweet strains of Frank Sinatra's voice were accompanied by the less than melodic warbling of a tone-deaf sheriff. Doreen, euphoric as never before in her 33 years, began to giggle infectiously. Swept away by the moment, Zeb Hanks belted it out with more false symphonic timbre than a dozen third-rate lounge acts.
"You'd never know it, but, buddy, I'm kind of a poet, and I've got a lot of things I'd like to say."
"Doreen, can you see the face of the man in the moon?"
"Of course."
"Can you hear what he's whispering?"
Doreen kissed her finger, pressed it against Zeb's lips, and turned an ear toward the brightly shining orb.
"I hear that old man in the moon all right, but I can't quite make out the words."
Zeb ran his tongue over her finger. She felt weak in the knees.
"Doreen?"
"Yes, Sugar Dumpling?"
"That sweet old man in the moon is saying, 'Will you marry me?'"
The hushed quiet of the night became palpable. Chirping crickets paused. Creatures of the night froze in mid-step. Even the warm evening breeze calmed as it awaited a reply. Doreen ran a caressing hand over her man's recently flattened stomach, stopping only when she reached the inside of his thigh. The tingle of pleasure it originally created suddenly turned to pain as she grabbed a pound of flesh.
"Ouch! Damn, what was that for?"
"I just wanted to make for certain you wasn't talking in your sleep, and that I wasn't dreaming."
Doreen drew her flushed body tightly into her man's loving arms.
"Before you answer," said Zeb, "there is one important thing you have to think about."
"Is this the part where you prattle on about the downside of being a sheriff's wife?"
"The cop's pay isn't so great, and the hours are terrible."
"Do you think for half of 1 minute, what with the path I've beat through my life, any of that would even matter?"
"It's not just..."
Before he could say another word, Doreen kissed him long and deep. She pulled back and stared into Zeb's moonlit eyes. Suddenly now didn't seem like the right time to tell her the Tucson Police Department had called today and made him an offer to return to his old position as a homicide detective. It sure as hell wasn't the time to let her know there were things he could never tell her about.
"Baby, I didn't fall in love with the badge. I fell in love with the man."
Her words rang true.
"It's just that I don't want you to worry every time the phone..."
As if on cue, the ringer on Doreen's phone pierced the special feeling of the moment. Goosebumps involuntarily flared from every pore of her body as she grabbed the receiver.
"Hello?
Doreen, this is Kate Steele. I'm so sorry to bother you, but I saw the sheriff's car parked in your driveway. I have to talk to him. It's important."
"Don't think twice, hon. It's all right. I know it's business. Hang on one short sec."
"It's Kate,"
whispered Doreen, handing him the phone.
"She says it's important."
"Deputy Steele, what's up?"
"We've got a situation."
"Go ahead."
"We've got a dead man, white male, undetermined age. We found his body 3 miles west of town on State Route 366, just beyond the Mount Graham Market."
"You know who it is?"
"Not yet. There was no ID. The body is mangled beyond recognition."
"Somebody dumped him there?"
"No."
"Cargo off the road?"
"No. Nothing quite that ordinary. It's rather strange. That's why I called you."
"Don't keep me in suspense, deputy."
Sheriff Hanks cradled the phone between his shoulder and his ear. Using his finger, he made a writing motion against the palm of his hand. Doreen had already anticipated his need and was reaching into the nightstand for a pen.
"It looks like a suicide."
"Suicide?" asked the sheriff.
"How do you figure?"
Heading into the kitchen to start a pot of coffee, Doreen reversed direction and returned to the bedroom upon hearing suicide. She sat next to Zeb, placing an understanding hand on the leg she'd just pinched.
"Give me what you got," said the sheriff, pointing to his pants and mouthing to Doreen, "I need my clothes."
"George Halverson, owner of the Mount Graham Market, called it in about 30 minutes ago. He was rousted out of bed by a frantic trucker banging on his door. Mr. Halverson described the driver as being in a state of shock. He said the trucker was unable to utter a complete thought. Even though George was in his pajamas, the trucker grabbed him by the arm and practically carried him to the spot where he'd just run over a man."
Was the victim walking along the side of the road?
That's the odd part. Apparently the dead man had placed his rocking chair in the westbound lane in a depression just beyond where the road crests.
Sweet mother of Jesus.
The mental image. A man sitting in a rocking chair on a dark, lonely stretch of road in the middle of the night, flattened by an 18-wheeler, made Zeb shudder. There's no way the driver barreling down the road at 70 miles an hour had any chance of seeing him, much less stopping. His truck hit the man head-on. The man and the rocking chair were smashed to pieces. I'm sure the man died instantly.
Thank God for small favors, mumbled the sheriff.
Pardon me, sheriff?
I was talking to myself. Go on.
The driver panicked. He flipped his rig over into the ditch when he realized what happened.
Have you talked with him?
He just keeps muttering. Man, rocking chair, middle of the road. I killed him.
Call Doc Yackley and let him know what's up. Better have him bring a sedative for the trucker. The poor son of a gun. Have Deputy Delbert get someone to tow the rig out of the ditch. I sure as hell don't want a bunch of gawkers hanging around there tomorrow morning causing more accidents. I'll be right there. Shouldn't take me more than 10 minutes.
I haven't completely surveyed the entire scene yet, replied Deputy Steele. I'll take care of things until you get here.
Zeb set the phone on the nightstand, tugged up his pants, and turned to Doreen. Now that's about the damnedest thing I ever heard.
What is? Tell me what happened, begged Doreen.
We've just had a suicide.
What's so crazy about that? There's been at least one every year since I moved to town, said Doreen. Some people get depressed and see no way out of it but dying.
It wasn't the suicide, though, said Zeb, slipping into his boots. It was how it happened.
Now, Dumplin', that ain't the kind of story you pull the reins in on halfway through. Tell you, sugar, what happened.
It seems somebody took a rocking chair and placed it in the middle of the highway.
Uh-oh.
Then they sat themselves down and waited for an 18-wheeler to come by and do the dirty work.
Oh, dear Lord. Did Kate say who it was?
The body was mangled pretty badly. I guess we don't know just yet who it is.
Is this the kind of thing you were warning me about? Middle-of-the-night phone calls and all that?
I was just trying to warn you death comes with the territory. I'm sorry to say it's part of the job.
No need to be sorry about that, replied Doreen. A man's got to do his job.
Zeb smiled and kissed her on the cheek.
Why don't you try and get some rest, he suggested. I'll come back when I see for myself what's happened. Good God almighty, you know I couldn't go back to sleep after hearing something like this. I might as well just go open up the cafe and get an early start on the day.
Okay, then I'll stop by the town talk after I have a look around out there.
Zeb, honey bear, it's not like this every night, is it?
No, replied the sheriff. It's usually pretty quiet.
Holding Doreen firmly in his arms, Zeb placed a parting kiss on her lips. Zeb, I've got just an awful feeling flowing through me right now. Baby, please be careful.
Don't worry, Doe. I'll be careful. I always am. The dull thud of Sheriff Zeb Hanks' boot heels on sidewalk cement and the distant hoot of a night owl broke the silence as dawn gave chase to what remained of the rapidly waning nighttime. Opening the door of his patrol car, Zeb glanced toward the arched doorway where Doreen's mindful eye had been trailing his every step.
You never did give me your final answer. What's it gonna be? Will you marry me? Shouted Zeb.
Hush up now, sugar pie. You're going to wake the entire neighborhood. Then I'll have a heap of explaining to do.
The sheriff turned his head toward a nosy neighbor's house as she flipped on an outside light and peeked through a curtain.
Well, what's it gonna be? Yes or no?
Gee whiz, honey bun, give a girl a little time to let a big old question like that sink into her heart, would you? It ain't every day someone offers up to change your life. Besides, it's good to keep a man wondering.
Zeb winked and waved.
Fair enough. Take all the time you need between now and the next time you see my smiling face, he said.
Doreen watched Zeb's car turn the corner and pass beneath a lone street lamp lighting the intersection at the end of the block.
I love you. When the time is right, I promise I'll tell you why I'm hesitant, she said softly. But something is scaring the bejesus out of me.
Chapter 3. The first rays of the rising sun sparkled crisply against the golden rock faces of the highest elevations of Mount Graham. The purity of a new day dawning on the mountaintop bumped hard against the ghastly death image burning inside the sheriff's head. Who would do such a thing to himself? Why choose such a dramatic statement? He found himself agitated as he thought of how horribly indecent it was to have drawn a complete stranger into the personal act of suicide. He thought of the truck driver. His thought was simple. Poor bastard will live with that the rest of his life. The sheriff's thought was interrupted by what seemed a flash of sunlight glinting off his rearview mirror. He stiff-armed the steering wheel, instinctively straightening his posture. He squinted into the rearview mirror for a closer look. What he had incorrectly assumed to be reflected sunlight abruptly transformed into a pair of high-beam headlights bearing down behind him at a dangerously fast pace. A split second later, a candy apple-red Cadillac sedan DeVille shot past him like a rocket. Dr. James Yackley was behind the wheel. Pressing down long and hard on the car horn, the old doctor stuck an arm out the window and gave the sheriff the thumbs-up sign as he left the police cruiser in the dust.
"Jesus H. Christ, Doc. You're going to get yourself killed if you don't slow down some,"
mumbled the sheriff as the whining Doppler effect of the car horn faded into the distance. 2 miles down the road, Sheriff Hanks pulled into the graveled parking lot of the Mount Graham Market. Doc's flaming red Cadillac was parked obliquely, driver door flung wide open, and the engine purring like a kitten. The sheriff reached in and switched off the ignition. The market was a converted farmhouse from a decades earlier cattle boom. It had definitely seen better days. The unpainted railing of the rotting wooden porch with half of its spindles missing was a perfect match for the toothless old-timers who idled their days away jawboning about what might have been while resting their aging carcasses on equally run-down chairs that lined the veranda. Death on the nearby road would give them fodder for half a year's worth of gossip. Beneath the eerie glow of a dust-covered neon bug zapper, George Grumpy Halverson sucked down hard on the last quarter inch of a cigarette stub. Sitting nearby, wrapped in an Indian blanket, a balding, middle-aged man with mutton-chop sideburns rocked catatonically. Grumpy peered over the top of his glasses and pinched the remaining life out of the cigarette between a smoke-stained, calloused thumb and bent finger. He pointed the sheriff toward the wreck with a slight nod of the head. At the edge of the parking lot, soft mauve and pink early-morning hues painted the desert floor with splashes of color. The beauty of the desert landscape was harshly disrupted by a series of bright red flares placed near the tipped-over semi-tractor trailer rig. Sheriff Hanks' deputy, Delbert Funk, surveyed the scene, hands on hips.
"We're over here, Sheriff."
Sheriff Hanks stepped over small splinter pieces of widely scattered rocking chair remains, making his way through the undergrowth.
"Watch where you're stepping, Sheriff."
The mangled wreck of a human body quickly came into the sheriff's scope of vision.
"The dead dude here is missing a few parts. We don't want to be destroying no evidence."
Deputy Delbert crouched down, shining his flashlight under a small creosote bush.
"Looky here," he exclaimed. "It's an arm, torn right off his body. I ain't never seen nothing like it."
"Where's the rest of the body?" asked the sheriff.
Delbert pointed the flashlight beam behind a big rock about 15 feet away.
"Scattered around, but most of it is right back there."
The dead man's remains were lying in a crumpled heap, stomach down. The head was twisted so far around on the body that it appeared like it had been placed backwards on his shoulders. A single open eyeball with the pupil dilated leaked a line of clear fluid.
"Looks like he's been crying, don't it, Sheriff? But I don't suppose he felt any pain when the truck hit him. Do you?"
Sheriff Hanks glanced down at the tears on the dead man's cheek.
"If he did, it sure as hell didn't last too long."
The sheriff directed the thin ray of flashlight beam down the left side of the dead man's body. The stub of his arm rested in a pool of dark liquid. Sheriff Hanks crouched. Something inside the ripped black shirt caught his attention. He reached in and pulled out a stiff white collar, like that of a cleric. Reaching forward, he dabbed a single finger into the thick and inky substance. He rubbed it in a circular motion between his thumb and first finger. A stain appeared on his roughened hand. Bringing his finger near his face, the sheriff took a shallow whiff. The unmistakable aromatic mixture of drying blood and death churned his stomach.
"Smells like skunked-up late-summer backwater, don't it, Sheriff?" said Delbert.
The sheriff pulled a handkerchief from his pocket and wiped away the greasy, sticky mixture.
"Jumpin' Jehovah!" cried Delbert.
Sheriff Hanks squinted in his deputy's direction.
"I think I'm standing on the dead man's hand."
"Take it easy, deputy. His hand is over there, buried under the sand in that pool of blood," replied the sheriff.
"No, it ain't, Sheriff. It ain't buried neath nothing except my foot."
"What are you talking about, Delbert?"
"Looky down here by my right foot. I just stepped on something. I ain't certain, but neath my boot it feels like a hand. It's giving me the willies."
Sheriff Hanks shined the light near the deputy's boot heel. "Lift up your foot, Delbert. I want to get a closer look." The big deputy gingerly lifted his right foot and balanced all 6 feet 6 inches of his 275-pound body on a nervously unsteady left leg.
"No, it's not a hand," said the sheriff. "It's just a rock and some dead cactus spines."
"Whoa, whoa!"
yelled Delbert, tipping over and crashing into the underbrush.
"Yow! Dang it all! Ouch! Ouch! Ouch!"
"You okay, Delbert?"
"I think so,"
cried the deputy, reaching back to rub his head.
"What the heck is this?"
"What's what?" asked the sheriff. Delbert reached behind a small bush that had cushioned his fall. Rubbing the back of his head and pulling cactus needles from his hair, Delbert handed a large book with a red leather cover to the sheriff.
"What the heck is a book doing out here?"
asked the deputy.
"It's a Bible," said the sheriff.
Sheriff Hanks instinctively opened the book. On the inside cover leaf was a handwritten inscription.
"To Michael, my blessed son, congratulations on this holy day, your ordination. I give you freely to God and the sacred order of St. Barnabas. I am proud to call you Father McNamara. Love, Mother."
Reading words of felicitation from a mother to her son gave the sheriff a shiver so powerful his shoulders jerked up involuntarily. But it was the flash of a second realization that nearly floored him.
"It's Father McNamara's Bible."
"No way!" exclaimed Delbert.
"From the inscription, it appears to be a gift from his mother on the day he became a priest."
"Jeez! Now ain't that something?" added Delbert. "I mean that he had it with him when he croaked. But we still don't know it's him."
Sheriff Hanks and Deputy Delbert Funk stared blankly at the Bible, averting their eyes from the butchered body.
"Say, ain't Father McNamara and Doreen real close friends?"
"I suppose they know each other from the cafe," replied the sheriff.
"No, I mean..."
Delbert's statement was cut short by a shout from Deputy Steele.
"Sheriff, I found a billfold. The driver's license and credit cards belong to Father McNamara."
Zeb's heart sank, as any hope of the body being someone other than the locally beloved Father McNamara faded quickly.
"Zeb!"
Doc Yackley's thundering voice startled the men as he came barreling toward them.
"What the hell? What are you doing, reading a book? Funny damn thing to be doing at a time like this."
"We ain't reading it, Doc. We're just looking at it,"
answered Deputy Funk.
"It's the personal holy Bible of Father McNamara."
Sheriff Hanks tucked the Bible under his arm and pointed at the body of the priest. Doc Yackley knelt near the dead man.
"Damn knees of mine," grumbled Doc.
"You all right, Doc?" asked Delbert.
"Just my age and a touch of the tiz. Nothing that being 20 years younger wouldn't cure," mumbled the doctor. "It's no damn concern of yours, that's for certain. Now, who identified this man as Father McNamara? There's not enough left of his face to recognize him."
The Bible is inscribed to him, and we got a wallet with his identification, said the sheriff.
I'll tell you in 10 seconds if it's him or not.
The old doctor unzipped the dead man's pants and pulled his underwear to the side, revealing a red birthmark the size of a baseball. He tugged on a plastic tube implanted in the priest's body.
Yep. We've got ourselves a dead priest, all right. This is Father McNamara.
The doctor reached over and pulled the forearm out of the sand.
You find his hand anywhere? Asked Doc. He seems to be missing it.
Over here, said Deputy Steele. I found it over here.
The doctor slowly brought himself to an upright position.
Let me give you a hand, Doc, said Deputy Funk.
Doc Yackley brushed aside the offer.
Is that some sort of pun, son?
Asked Doc Yackley. Delbert scratched his head as Sheriff Hanks chuckled.
Just a little gallows humor, young man, added the doctor. Don't worry your pretty little head about it.
Don't worry, Doc, I won't. I never worry about nothing, replied Deputy Delbert.
Deputy Delbert and Sheriff Hanks shined their flashlights on the severed hand, an unnecessary act as the sun had risen well past dawn.
It's a human hand, all right. A left one.
Upon hearing Doc's explanation, Deputy Delbert glanced down at his palm, then the back of his own left hand. He repeated this gesture several times before finally extending his arm and holding his hand directly in his line of vision with the severed hand in the background.
Yep, it's a southpaw, all right. And there's a ring on the third finger.
Doc reached forward and carefully scraped particles of dirt and sand from the severed hand.
With an inscription.
He reached into his coat pocket and removed a pair of bifocals. Sheriff Hanks and his deputy leaned forward as Doc brought his face to within inches of the excised hand.
Let's see here. It's written in Latin. You read Latin, Doc?
The savvy old country doctor winked at the sheriff.
I suppose I'm going to have to if I want to know what this damn ring says.
No fooling, Doc. You can do that? You can just look at another language and read it?
Asked Delbert.
Now that's really something. Helps being a doctor. A lot of our secret stuff is written in Latin and Greek.
Oh, I see, replied the deputy.
That makes a heap of sense. Now let me see. It says here, Ordinus Sancti Barnabae Vat Astronomicis Observatorium Basilicum Sancti Petri. I would say that translates roughly as Order of St. Barnabas, Vatican Astronomical Observatory, Basilica St. Peter. There's a picture here, too.
Doc Yackley squinted, moving his head a bit closer to the ring. After a moment, he took off his glasses and cleaned them on his untucked and rumpled shirt.
There, that ought to make seeing things a bit smoother.
Returning the cheaters to his face, Doc scrunched his cheekbones back and forth, allowing his glasses to slip down to the tip of his nose.
Yes, that's better. It's a picture of a building. It looks sort of like an old-fashioned tower up on a hillside in front of a church. Likely the Vatican Astronomical Observatory.
The rising sun now fully illuminated the eastern slopes of Mount Graham. Coming from the direction of town, Sheriff Hanks eyed the hearse from Shepner's funeral home making its way down Route 366 toward the death scene.
Never a welcome sight, is it?
Said Doc Yackley, observing the sheriff honing in on the death wagon.
Nope, never is. Doesn't seem to be much of a need for a full-blown autopsy. I'll take some blood and tissue and give it a routine once over. Is that okay with you?
Inquired the doctor.
I mean, with the birthmark and the colostomy bag, odds are 1 in 1,000,000 it could be anyone else.
Colostomy bag? Asked Sheriff Hanks.
Father McNamara had stage 4 colorectal cancer. He was in the end stages of life. He had a month at best. He was headed for hospice care real soon.
Zeb and Doc exchanged a glance that spoke to the hidden fear all people have. What would they do under the same circumstances?
Out of respect for his position at the church, I imagine it will be just fine if we let Shepners do their business and leave it at that, replied the sheriff.
I think the cause of death is pretty damn obvious. No sense making it any worse for his congregation by delaying the funeral.
I guess that settles it. I'll take some blood samples and get my medical report to you later this morning. The official cause of death looks like it's going to be suicide, unless that trucker over there's got a different story.
Doc Yackley pointed to the porch, where the distraught trucker continued his manic rocking.
Why don't you come along, and we'll have a little chat with him. That way he can say it once, and hopefully I can be done with it, legally anyhow, suggested Zeb.
Let's get crackin', then, said Doc. I'd like to grab a bite of breakfast before I start my rounds at the hospital. Better have Delbert snoop around a little more before they load up the body.
Father McNamara is missing both his shoes, and his left foot was severed just above the ankle.
And don't forget the hand. Make sure Shepner's gets it.
Oh, crap, moaned Delbert. More missing body parts. Gad, I hate touching that kind of stuff. It gives me the creeps.
Deputy Delbert Funk half-heartedly began to look around for the shoes and missing foot of the priest, as the hearse driver and his assistant came scrambling up the small knoll with a stretcher. Sheriff Hanks and Doc Yackley slowly made their way toward the Mount Graham market and the traumatized trucker.
I already gave him a light sedative, 10 milligrams of Valium, to calm his nerves. Poor son of a bitch was pretty shook. He should be okay to talk, unless the Valium fogs him out.
Grumpy Halverson and the truck driver sat on the porch chairs sipping coffee. The trucker stared off into space, mumbling incoherently as he swayed rhythmically to some unheard beat.
Doc, that shot you gave him made him a little goofy, so I gave him a little good-morning cactus juice to straighten him up. I figured the sheriff would want to have a word or two with him. Fellow says his name is Billy Joe Thomas. Operates his rig out of Yuma.
Thanks, George.
Billy Joe, my name is Sheriff Hanks. You already met Doc Yackley.
Sheriff Hanks, pleased to meet you. Dr. Yackley, whatever you gave me sure helped to calm down my jits.
I'm glad it helped, smiled Doc. It's been a rough day for you.
You can say that again.
A wave of pity came over Zeb. He knew that killing a man, even accidentally, was a shocking burden that would lessen with time but never go away.
I need to go over a few things with you, began the sheriff, for my official report. You feel like talking?
I suppose. It's got to be done sooner or later.
At the mention of the accident, the trucker increased his nervous swaying.
Why don't you start by telling me what happened? Said the sheriff.
I wasn't speeding, and I wasn't over on my driving time. You can go right ahead and check my log. I swear, I wasn't even tired.
Uh-huh.
Go ahead and tell me what happened, said the sheriff.
There's not much to say, really. It was so weird. It was almost like it happened in slow motion. At first, I thought I was seeing things. You would have, too. I mean, it isn't every day you see something like that.
What did you see?
I was heading west on 366, doing about 63, 64 miles per hour. Not so fast that I didn't have complete control of my rig. Anyway, back up that way.
The trucker weakly lifted a shaky arm and pointed down the road.
Where the highway begins to rise up, a coyote scampered across the road. I watched him skulk off into the desert. I remember thinking the little critter looked mighty scruffy. When I looked back up, right over there where the road peaks and then goes down into that little depression, I caught sight of something out of the corner of my eye. At first, I couldn't believe I was seeing what I was seeing. It didn't make any sense in my mind. Right there in the middle of the road was a man dressed all in black.
The trucker became mute as he stared at the accident site.
Pardon me, Sheriff, but I was seeing it all over again.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.